Let us continue with whatever topic we had done yesterday on equilibrium of rigid bodies, but specifically we will discuss about frames and machines. So what I want to emphasize is that in yesterday's class we briefly discussed about what is meant by rigid body and what is meant by equilibrium of a rigid body. We saw that for any given free body, sum of all the forces should be equal to zero for it to be in equilibrium. And sum of all the moments should be equal to 0, okay. So when both of these criteria are satisfied, we say that a rigid body is in equilibrium. Then yesterday we briefly discussed about what is the role of supports in equilibrium. We saw that there are various type of supports and there can be various types of linkages which can be used to keep structures or rigid bodies in equilibrium under the action of various forces. Then we saw that there are constraints and there are reactions, and as a result there is an intricate relationship between the kinematics, which really is it deals with motion, and the corresponding reactions. So what we saw is that if a particular constraint constrains a degree of freedom, which is a kinematic degree of freedom, then it gives rise to the corresponding reaction. And if a support moves freely, okay, in a particular degree of freedom without allowing full motion of that particular degree of freedom, then there is no reaction from the support in that direction. So then we discussed about free body diagrams. We discussed free body diagrams of very simple structures. Now we solved a few problems, and this is where we stopped yesterday. This is the material which I wanted to cover yesterday, but I couldn't get the time. So let us begin briefly with what we mean as a two force member. This is an extremely important concept, okay, that we emphasize to the students, that recognizing that particular components of a structure are two force members can greatly simplify a problem. So what, there are various examples of two force members. Say, what is the definition of a two force members really is that we have a linkage, no matter what that linkage, what kind of shape it has, and it is connected at two ends with typically a pin joint. What does that mean? That there can only be a force that can acting here, there can only be a force that can act here. And if, because these forces are much larger compared to the self weight of this member, then in that case we can assume this as a two force member. That is, the line of action of this reaction and this reaction, they pass along the line joining these two ends, okay. We will discuss briefly in some details. So this, for example, is a door stopper. This is another example of a two force member. So this is a part of a bridge, they are connected to each other. So this is a linkage, these are two pins, okay. So this is another example of two force member. This is one particular some particular form of a machine, okay, which is used to some variant of a plier, in which what you have is that this link is connected by two screws here. And this is another example of a two force member. And the most popular example of two force member, and the most and one of the most useful examples of two force member that we will see, is this hydraulic cylinder, okay. And what that is, we'll briefly look, okay, in some details. Now what is a two force member? So two force member, okay, if you draw the free body diagram of the two force member, what we had seen earlier, now this is a pin connection, this is a pin connection. And what we say is that the force that are transmitted to the pin connection. Now we saw yesterday that at a pin connection, the force, because the pin connection is restricting the degree of freedom in the horizontal direction as well as degree of freedom in the vertical direction, we can replace that particular kinematic constraint with two forces, one in the horizontal direction, one in the vertical direction. Or as many of you pointed out yesterday, we can replace that with an unknown, with a force acting in an unknown direction. Similarly, at this point, okay, since this is a two force member, since this is a pin connection, you will see that there will be forces possible in vertical direction or in horizontal direction. Or in other words, there can be a reaction acting or there can be a force acting on it in a particular direction. Now what is the criteria for this member to be in equilibrium? Now clearly, for this to be in equilibrium, sum of all the forces should be equal to 0. Now let's say that if this force is vertical then this force also has to be vertical. Now think about it, if this is vertical, clearly equilibrium condition is obeyed in the horizontal direction, okay. Equilibrium condition is obeyed for force balance in the vertical direction, but it is not obeyed for torque balance, because this positive F and negative F, they create a torque or a moment or a couple, okay, whatever way you want to see about it, okay. So plus F minus F, so F into the distance will be the anti-clockwise couple that will be created, and as a result, because of this anti-clockwise couple, this body won't be in equilibrium. And we can convince ourselves that the only possible way in which this two force member can be in equilibrium is if the line of action of this force is along the line connecting these two joints, and they should be equal and opposite. Now if that is satisfied, note that we can take our x axis along this direction, there is no force in the y direction, so equilibrium in the y direction is automatically satisfied, and equilibrium in x direction is also satisfied, because this is plus F, this is minus F, sum is 0, and because these two forces are acting along the same line, they don't cause any couple, and as a result the moment balance is also satisfied. So this is one way in which the forces can act. The other way they can act is that instead of acting outwards, they can act inwards. Now one point that, for example, we emphasize to the students a lot is that two force members is independent of what is the shape of this member. We don't worry that if this is a L shape, it's a C shape, it's a straight line. Only thing we should be worried about, okay, that we emphasize to the students is what is the line which is connecting the two joints. And when we find out that line, the only thing that the two force member, another thing that we observe is that, are there any other forces acting on this member other than these two end forces? If not, then it's a two force member, and irrespective of the shape of the member, we have the line of action of the forces along the line which is joining the two ends where the force acts. So this is a very, very important concept, very useful concept, and we will discuss this concept. We will solve a lot of problems on two force members. Now next very important example is the example of a hydraulic cylinder, okay. So what does a hydraulic cylinder do? So if you have seen many construction sites, so this, for example, Caterpillar is one big company which produces many of these cranes. Now what do they do is that there are various functions affiliated with that. They have a hydraulic cylinder like this, which is operated by a pneumatic device, okay. Some fluid device present inside, which raises or lowers what is called as a boom, and because of that you can change the configuration of the structures, make this go up, make this go down, make this turn, twist, and do all manner of things that are required for construction purposes. So I have a mathematical demo here, okay. Unfortunately my computer is having some problems, so let me fix it by the break, during the break, and I can show you a nice animated demo of how this hydraulic cylinder typically works and how does it change configurations, okay. Now next concept that we come to is equilibrium of a three force body. Now this is a very useful concept, but it can be a little bit problematic. So in principle it is very nice, but in practice, okay, one has to be very careful when you are using it. So before we go on to the details, let us see what is a three force body. The three force body essentially is, so like a two force member where the forces acted only at two points. So one force acted at one point, other force acted at another point. We join the line connecting the two points where the force acted, and the line and what we saw is that for the body to be in equilibrium, the force, two forces should pass along the line joining the two points of action of those two forces, or in other words, the line of action of the two forces should be exactly be the same and the forces should be equal and opposite. Now in a three force member, what we have is that a force acts at one point A, another force acts at another point B, and third force acts at a third point C. Now we know from our geometry that when two force acts on when two lines, they can always meet at a point. So we extend this line, so this is the line of action of force 1, so this is line, this is line of action of force 2, so these two meet at point D, okay, and they will always meet at point D. Now the third force, for this body to be in equilibrium, better also pass through point D, because if it does not pass through point D, then what will happen is that we can take force balance about point D, and these two forces don't cause any moment about point D, whereas this force, if it doesn't pass through point D, will cause a moment about point D and will cause the body to rotate, just nullifying our assumption that the body is in equilibrium. So as a result, if three forces act on a body at three different points which are not in the straight line, then they should meet at a point. Now this idea can be used to solve problems in an elegant manner, although it is not pretty intuitive. At least I feel it is not always useful. We will see that, for example, we will solve a few problems later on where you can very nicely use this concept, but we will see that it need not be always used in a simple manner, and we will discuss that with an example. Okay, so let us do one simple example here. So what we have, this is a sample problem from BJ 10. So we have a rod AB, okay. The rod has some weight, okay, which effective weight which passes through the center of mass of the rod through the center of AB in the vertical direction. Now this rod, we want to hoist it up by hinging around point A. And how are we going to hoist it? We are applying a tension through a rope which is connected at point B, and we are pulling on it. Now what we want to know, that when this rod is in this configuration, okay, the weight of the rod is 10 kg, and when the rod is in this particular configuration, all the angles are given. This is 45 degree, the angle the rope makes with the rod is 25 degree. We are asked to find out what is the tension in this rope and what is the effective reaction acting at point A. Effective reaction is the total reaction ax square plus ay square, the square root of that, and the direction of that reaction is what we are asked to find out. Now this problem is a really straightforward problem. You can use force balance, moment balance, three equations of equilibrium. Why? Because there are three unknowns here, ax, ay. There is another unknown here, which is the tension. So three equations we can write for one free body diagram in 2D, and three equations, three unknowns, this problem is very easily solved. But now what we do is that, let us use the concept of three force body that we just saw and find out what is the reaction that acts at point A and what is the tension that acts at what is the tension that acts in this rope. Now note one thing, that in this problem we know what is the direction of this rope. We also know what is the direction and what is the point through which the weight acts, which is here. So we know the line of action of two forces, and we need to find out what is this force and what is the line of action of this reaction. Now we use simple geometry. So weight passes through G center, okay, AG is equal to GB, this angle is 45 degrees. So this is the line of action of the weight, this is the tension, this is the line of action of the tension. We know that these two will meet at point C, okay, by definition two straight lines will always meet, if they are not parallel they will always meet at a point. Now this third reaction should pass through this point, because if it does not, then this will cause a moment about point C and the body will no longer be in equilibrium. Now all it remains for us is to understand what is this unknown angle alpha that this reaction makes with the horizontal. And to do that, we just use some geometry. Okay, how do we use that? Okay, it's pretty simple, but kind of complicated, that it's prone to some errors because the geometry is not straightforward. All the numbers involved, 25 degrees and all, are not perfectly good numbers, like 30 degrees, 60 degrees, or 45 degrees. There may be some issue, but overall, conceptually, the process is straightforward. So BF is this distance. What is this BF? Is nothing but AB cos 45. Straightforward. We get this value of BF. Now what we want to find out is, what is this distance CD? Now what is this distance CD? This distance CD is nothing but equal to AE, because this is the center line, okay, this passes through the center. So by simple geometry, CD will be equal to AE, which equal to half of AF. AF is given to us. Why? Because that's what we found out, that BF is equal to AF. AF is equal to AB cos 45. So we know what is CD. Now what we do is that, we find out what is this tiny distance BD, which is nothing but CD cot 25 plus 45, okay. So it is so CD cot 25 plus 45, so we get this answer equal to 0.515, and ultimately we find out what is this CE, which is nothing but equal to DF, which is BF minus BD. So after doing all this somewhat involved trigonometry, what we finally get is, what is the value of CE? Now I know what is the value of CE. We have already found out what is the value of AE, and so we can use simple trigonometry to say that tan of this unknown alpha, will be equal to 2.313 divided by 1.414, which is C divided by AE. We get what is tan alpha, and from that we can find out alpha, which in this problem turns out to be 58.6. Okay, it is just use of geometry, but only thing is that you have to go through multiple steps. Now what we know? We know that the line of action of this reaction is 58.6 degree. We also know from the parallelogram law or Lamy's theorem, okay, that all these three should form a nice triangle, okay, in this form. So this is reaction R, whose angle is now known? Weight acted vertically, okay. We also know that this tension T, okay, acted at an angle of 25 degrees with respect to this rod, but because we now know all these inclinations, we can also immediately find out what is the overall inclination of this tension with respect to this reaction. So we know this triangle with all these angles, and we also know what is the weight of the rod, which is nothing but W times G, which is 98.1 Newton. And so using sine law or Lamy's theorem, okay, whatever you want to call it, we immediately write it. So T divided by 31.4 sine of 31.4 is equal to R divided by sine of 110 is equal to 98.1 divided by 38.6, and then we can immediately find out what is the tension. We immediately know what is the reaction, total reaction, and we also know the angle. Okay, so this is one way in which you can solve problems where force acts exactly at three points. So these are typically three force bodies, and we can use this simple conceptually simple ideas to solve this problem. But note one thing, that if we had used principle of force balance and moment balance, then we could have got an answer in just three lines. Just take torque about this point, you can immediately find out what is the tension. Take equilibrium in the y direction, you get reaction in the y direction. Equilibrium in the x direction, immediately you get reaction in the x direction, and you are done. Okay, whereas here you have to use somewhat involved geometry, so it's a matter of taste if you want to use it or not use it. But we will see when we solve certain problems that when the geometry is nicer, then this method becomes extremely powerful. But in this case, I believe that this method doesn't carry significant advantage over doing simple force balance and moment balance. Okay, now let us come back. So after discussing all these things, let us come to the main topic of today's workshop, of today's session. Is in yesterday's lecture we discussed only about single rigid bodies which are supported by various kind of constraints, but the more interesting problems are the problems in which there are multiple rigid bodies that are connected to each other. And we will see that there are many challenging problems that arise because of that, and we will see that what are the various methods, what are the intuitive techniques that we use in order to understand how to find out the reactions from the supports and the reaction between linkages when we have multiple rigid bodies that are connected to each other. Okay, so this is one simple demo. So this is a simple demo of an exercise machine. So this simple exercise machine, what we have here is that this particular component, okay, we use there is a weight that is tied here, we apply forces here, okay, this is a fulcrum, we apply force such that this is free to rotate, and then in particular configuration, typically exercise is done in a quasi static manner so as to get the maximum out of it. So this entire rod is in equilibrium around this line in essentially each and every configuration. Now what we do in typical engineering mechanics problem is that we have to emphasize this to the students, that we have a real life problem, we have a real world problem. What we do is that we create a caricature out of it. Now this real exercise machine, we create a cartoon of this, and we see is that this cartoon, what do we have? That this hinge is like this, and this essentially is just a demo problem we show to the students so that they can visualize it and they can see that, for example, what are happening here. So this is a screw over which the rotation can happen. See, this is the screw, okay, this is the exercise component, this is the hole which is slotted through the screw, okay, and these are the various connections, we can think about them, okay. If you look from the side, what is happening here is that, okay. So these are the various angles from which we see the machine, and ultimately what we do, final piece of the modeling, that these are the loads that we exert from our side, this is the weight, these are the reactions that exert that this portion exerts at this joint, and this is one reaction, this is other reaction, and if they are symmetric, then we can deal with this exercise machine only from one side, and this becomes our 2D problem. This is a pin connection, okay, these are the reactions that are exerted by one part on the other part, okay. So there is this bench, there is the fulcrum, so bench exerts load on the fulcrum, how? through this connection, and these are the reaction site connection. Because it's a pin joint, it prevents translation in the horizontal direction as well as in the vertical direction, and so it will give rise to these two reactions. So this is AX, this is AY, this is the weight, this is the force, and now this is how we have taken this real life problem and converted that into a 2D caricature problem, which we will now analyze using various methods. Okay. Now, let us come to what we discussed as structures. So, the topic of today's lecture is structures and machines. We will now come to simple structures. Okay. Now, for equilibrium of structures made of several connected parts, okay, we have to consider the internal forces as well as the external forces. If you recall, all the problems we solved yesterday, the forces typically were all external, except the problem about the cylinder and a man walking into the cylinder, where we also had one internal force. Okay, otherwise all the forces were external. Now, the internal forces for the equilibrium structure made of several connecting parts, the internal forces as well as external forces are considered. Okay, now what we do is that in the interaction between the connected parts, Newton's third law states. Okay, so if we draw the free body diagram, okay, of this complete structure, we cut the cable here. So what we have, this cable is replaced with a tension T. We take this structure, isolate it. This is a hinge joint. Now in a hinge joint, what happens is that the translation in the x direction is prevented, the translation in the y direction is prevented. That will give rise to two reactions, AX and AY. Okay, so we draw here. If we isolate this member CEF, note one thing, that C is connected to DA with a pin connection. So note that the rotation is free, but the two translations are constrained. So as a result, okay, on this member CEF, we will have two forces, okay, acting in the vertical horizontal direction. Now Newton's third law dictates that this member will exert an equal and opposite force on the member to which it is connected. So if this is horizontal, this is horizontal, but in the opposite direction, this is downwards, this is upward, equal and opposite. So this is the free body diagram. Note one thing, that BE is now a two force member. Why? Because the force acts only through these joints. We are neglecting the weight of this member. So BE, we say that this should be the line of action of the two forces along BE, plus minus like this. Now this is assumed to be in compression. If the force at joint B, okay, acts in this direction, Newton's third law dictate that the force that this exerts on this vertical member should be equal and opposite, and at joint E, the force direction on member B is this. So by Newton's third law, it should be equal and opposite at this point. So these are the free body diagrams of all the individual members, and then we analyze all these free body diagrams depending on what is asked of us to find out what are the corresponding forces and what are the corresponding reactions. So under structures, there are three typical categories that we encounter. One is trusses. So trusses are typically formed of two force members, which Professor Banerjee will teach cover in tomorrow's class. What we are going to cover in today's class are frames and machines. So frames are the portion which contains at least one multi-force member. So what is a multi-force member? That it's that the forces don't act only at the ends in this manner. The moment there is some other force acting in between, this becomes a multi-force member, that we cannot immediately say that what is the direction of the forces acting at this joint, what is the direction of forces acting at this joint. Whereas here, only the magnitude is unknown, but the direction is completely known. Okay. And then some of the most interesting problems come under this category machines, and we will discuss some of these problems in today's class. We come to analysis of frames. Okay, so not a big deal. Okay, the theory, nothing. Just take this frame, whatever free body diagram we draw a few moments ago, essentially the philosophy remains the same. In principle, you are given a frame, you are given loads on the frame. The simplest and the most naive thing to do is just break open everything. Okay, just go for the broke, open each and every joint, see what possible members. Is a two force member? Okay, this is a two force member. Okay, so the forces should act along the line joining the two force member. Okay, this B is connected to member BE, it is also connected to DA. So what should happen? If the force on BE acts in this direction, equal and opposite force should act at point B, which is now common also to joint to member DA. Okay, so just these simple things. Okay, what happens? Joint C is common both to the vertical member DCBA, it is also common to CEF. So horizontal, vertical, equal and opposite on this member. Just as simple as that. But the trick lies not in just mindlessly disassembling. That's what we have to emphasize, okay? And that's what we all emphasize our students, but there are certain tricks in order to understand that what are the appropriate free body diagrams to choose. Now think about it. If you want to analyze this particular frame, then you can just disassemble everything and see what are the unknowns. Two unknowns here, three, four, this, five, six. So you say there are six unknowns. How many free body diagrams you can draw? One free body diagram, two free body diagram. Note that this is not a free body diagram because you cannot do anything about it. Plus minus, it is a self-equilibrating member. You cannot draw, you cannot write down extra equations of equilibrium for this. But we have six unknowns, six equations, great, we can solve. But the point is that if we mindlessly solve, just like draw free body diagrams like this, write six equations, six unknowns, you will see that most of the equations will be completely coupled to each other. And if you have a computer in front of you, if you have a software like Mathematica at your disposal, you are great. You just type in all the equations, solve them using Mathematica, gone. 6 by 6 matrix, it will solve in 2 seconds. But if you want to solve it by hand, this is a procedure which is fraught with errors. So because of that, the trick, okay, because the concept is very simple, but the trick is in really identifying what is that, what is it that is asked of us and what should be the appropriate free body diagrams that we should draw for this particular truss member, okay. So we will discuss that in a few moments. Now there is this one extremely interesting concept, okay, which comes only in multiply connected members. This concept never arises when you have a single rigid body. Now there are these structures which are frames which cease to be rigid when detached from their supports. Okay, we will demonstrate this with a simple example. Okay, this example is taken from B&J, but there are infinite of such examples that you can have a look at. Just see, so we have a member AC, we have a member CB. Now one of the things that we have noted that students have a quick tendency, oh this is a member, okay, this is a pin member, this is a two force member. But this is not a two force member, why? Because there is a vertical load that is passing through the center, okay. So the force is not acting at two points, it is acting at three points. So this is not a two force member, this is a regular non two force member. Same goes for member CB, it is not a two force member. Now what happens is that just use simple geometry, this is a triangle. Okay, this is a triangle, this length is fixed, this is fixed, this is fixed. Now if you want to change the configuration of this triangle, think about it. If you want to move this position C somewhere else because A and B are completely fixed, then what you have to do? You cannot do that without extending or compressing any of these members. So because of that, this configuration is said to be a rigid configuration. Why? The meaning simply being that this configuration cannot be changed without deforming any individual member just by simple combination of rigid motions. So this is a rigid frame. But think about it. If you replace this point B with a roller, then what happens? You can easily move this, you can rotate this, you can slide this, and you can see that this triangle, you can change its configuration without changing the length of any of the members. Now in that case, it ceases to be rigid. Okay, it is called as a non-rigid member, or if I remove both of the supports, okay, you will see that any support you release, this will become a non-rigid. What does that mean? That the configuration can be changed without changing the length of any of the members. Now what happens in this kind of configurations, you note that you cannot find even the reactions, okay, at support A and support B. You cannot take one full free body diagrams and can get all the four reactions because it's a pin joint, two reactions. Pin joint, two reactions, we cannot get four reactions because if you take the full free body diagram, then we have three equations, four unknowns, we are done. But this is not a statically indeterminate problem. Why? Because we can draw two separate free body diagrams, this and this. Two unknowns here, CY, CX, equal and opposite, because these are connected to each other, equal and opposite acting here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we have six unknowns. Three equations for this, three equations for this, six equations, six unknowns. This is a statically determinate structure. But the interesting thing about this, which you never saw in the previous problems, is that unless we do an internal analysis, unless we isolate a member which is inside, we can never solve this problem. We can never get all the reactions and all the forces. So that means that these are the frames which cease to be rigid when detached from their supports. Okay? And when we do principle of virtual work, you will see that how can we actually visualize that if we release any support, what is the resulting kinematics of this particular frame. Now these non-rigid structures are also referred to in mechanical engineering as mechanisms. Okay? So sometimes I will use the word mechanisms, sometime I will use the word non-rigid structures, but they are interchangeable and they mean the same. Now, there are more of these examples, okay. Look at this structure. This structure is perfectly rigid, okay. It is a perfectly stable structure when you have a proper connection here, a pin connection at point A, a pin connection at point C. But think about it, the moment you make this as a roller or this as a roller, anything, or you release this, okay, you completely release this, then what you can convince yourself, think about it, is that this is a quadrilateral, and in a quadrilateral you can always make infinitesimal changes and change its shape without actually deforming any of the members, okay. This is, you convince yourself, you can draw simple diagrams for yourself and you can convince that if I isolate this structure from joint A and joint C, this resulting structure we can deform, we can change its configuration, okay. We can bring it in, we can bring it out without changing the length of any individual members, and as a result, upon removing it from the supports, okay, this becomes a non-rigid structure, and then it becomes clear that if I want to find out all the internal forces, forget about internal forces, if I want to find out even the reactions 1, 2, 3, 4, we cannot find out without separating or without drawing the free body of any internal member and then drawing the appropriate free body diagram and the corresponding equations of equilibrium. Now, note how many unknowns we have here, 1, 2, 3, 4, this is a 2 force member, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So, we have 9 unknowns, we have 9 unknowns, and how many free body diagrams we have, 1, 2, 3. So, 3, 4 free body diagrams, 3 into 3 unknowns, 3 equations, 9 equations, 9 unknowns, this is a statically determinate structure. And there is another subtle point which I want to emphasize, but this is in too much details, okay, this is not a very straightforward point, that even though the number of equations is equal to number of unknowns, okay, let us see, if we get the time we will discuss some of those problems, even then there is no guarantee that this structure is a stable structure or it is not a mechanism, okay. The number of equations and number of unknowns being equal, okay, is no guarantee that the structure is stable. But by and large, the problems that we will encounter in engineering mechanics, if this criteria is satisfied, then you are good to go. And note another thing, that many of us had a question yesterday about what happens that, for example, if some number of equations is more than, is number of equations is less than the number of unknowns. If that is true, then we can clearly say that there is no unique solution to this problem, or there are infinite of solutions to that problem. And the unique solution now is found out only by using techniques that we typically deal with in structural mechanics or solid mechanics. Now, note one thing, okay, that there is another case. We just saw that the number of equations is equal to number of unknowns. Now, what happens if the number of equations is actually more than the number of unknowns? The number of equations becoming more than the number of unknowns will clearly be seen if you replace this C, which is a pin joint, with a roller. And you can mathematically demonstrate using principles of linear algebra that this will become a mechanism, and there will be some forces that can act on the structure, and the structure can no longer be in equilibrium, and the equations of equilibrium hence will have no solution, okay. So, these are the points to keep in mind, they will become more clear as we proceed further. This is another example of the structure which is completely rigid, which means that you cannot change the configuration of the structure without making changes in the length of any of the members. But if you release it from the supports, it ceases to be a rigid structure, and in this structure, even to get these simple things as the reactions at point D and reactions at point A, you have to go internally and analyze the forces in any of the members, okay. So, with this preamble, let us solve a couple of problems, or what we do is that we can have a 5-minute brief question and answer session, and then we will go to problem solving.
1145.
Internal hinge, where does an internal hinge arise?
Okay, so it is not a question of internal hinge arising or not, it is a part of the problem that if you are designing your structure in such a way. So, just look here, this configuration, it is not a question of when does the internal hinge arise, maybe it is a matter of terminology. We have made this structure in such a way that these two joints are connected with a pin connection. Now, pin connection, like we discussed for the support reactions, what did we discuss here? This is also a pin connection, this is also a pin connection. So, there is strictly speaking no difference, but the main difference here is that here this joint C, we are completely restricting the motion of these joints in the horizontal and in the vertical direction, whereas at internal points D, what we are ensuring is that that there is no separation. Now see, this point D, which is a hinge, is common to BC and it is common to ED. So there are two members for which this hinge is common. Now the presence of an internal hinge, what does it do? That it prevents relative separation between BC and ED in the horizontal direction as well as in the vertical direction, and as a result it gives rise to, when we draw the appropriate free body diagram, to forces in the horizontal direction, forces in the vertical direction when you isolate them. But note one thing, that because it's a hinge, okay, it is free to rotate, this angle is free to change, and as a result this connection is incapable of providing any internal moments. So when we draw the free body diagram, okay, we just replace this internal hinge with two forces in x and y direction. So when you say it arises, I take it to mean that what happens when you put an internal hinge here as far as the free body diagram of that structure is concerned. I hope that answers the question. If not, you can ask further.
One doubt is got.
Yes,
all pin joints should be there on top in this problem, or shall we fix only any fixed in between that A and F?
It doesn't matter. It can be anywhere. See, because for example, we look at all our structures around us, right? For example, just look our simple pliers which we use to carry utensils. The pin joint is in between somewhere, okay? You can look at so many different structures, okay, bookshelf, so many other things where the pin joint can be in between. Only, see, what we want is this. We want to design our structure in such a way that ultimately it doesn't become a mechanism. It is rigid. For example, if we build a structure like this, okay, this is a pin joint, okay? This is another pin joint. It is like this, and then I put two hinges here. Okay, I can build a structure like this. Okay, so I can put a pin joint here. I can put a pin joint here also, like this. This is, I can say that this is a side bracing. Okay, but note one thing, that this structure is no good structure. Why? Because this can just deform like this.
Okay, deformation will be less at.
It is not deformation. Deformation, I use the wrong word. You can change the configuration without changing the length of any members. The length of all members will remain the same, but the effective configuration changes. So this is a mechanism or a non-rigid structure. So what we want to do is that we want to put whatever things that are required appropriately so that the final structure remains in equilibrium. And if you put more constraints, for example, instead of putting a pin, we put a weld, then the structure becomes statically indeterminate. Okay, so instead of pin, you can put a weld there, nothing wrong. But only thing is that now the structure becomes statically indeterminate. It's fine? Statically indeterminate, if you put a weld instead of a pin in this case. Okay, we'll take one last question and then we'll proceed further. We'll have another extensive discussion afterwards. We'll take one more question. Yes, yes.
What about the moments in the joints of a frame, sir?
So that's a good question. So this is what I emphasized. Say, for example, that's the connection, okay? So look at this thing. In this structure, for example, this is one part of a structure. If these two members, let me say that this is member AB, okay, and this is member CD, I am only isolating one part of the structure. The remainder of the structure can be here, and so on. I just zoom in onto this joint. Now note here that if this is a pin joint, we again ask ourselves the question, what is this pin joint doing? Now this pin joint O is common to DC, it is common to AB. What is this pin joint doing? Because of this pin joint, we cannot separate these two members horizontally. There cannot be any gap that can be created. There cannot be a vertical gap that can be created because of the presence of this joint. And what we had seen, that if we constrain any degree of freedom, that will give rise to a corresponding force. Now, because we are constraining relative motion between these two in the vertical direction as well as in the horizontal direction, if we write down the free body diagram of AB, you can, in principle, I am not saying that you will always get horizontal and vertical direction. Sometimes it can be horizontal, sometimes it can be vertical. It all depends on what is the applied load on the system. But in principle, this joint is capable of providing two reactions like this, AX and AY. Now your question is that why is there not an internal moment? And that is the same thing, that if this joint is well lubricated, which we assume most of the time, that the screw, for example, we are used to put it, or a rivet we are using, is not rusted, for example, it is well lubricated, then the rotation is free. So that degree of freedom is not constrained, and as a result we say that there is no torque. Because why? Because the relative rotation between these two members is free, and so we don't put an external torque or an external moment at this point. This we don't put it. Whereas instead of having a pin joint, if we put a weld, then we are restricting even the relative rotation, and in that case, when we draw the free body diagram, I have to put this external moment at joint A. Is it clear? So I think what we will do now is that, so there are few problems that I want to solve. We will solve them for say 15-20 minutes, and then we will, what we will do today is we will not do a tutorial, wholesale tutorial. We will like take problems in batches, okay? So let us move back to our lecture. We will have an extensive discussion after that. So this is one simple problem. Note one thing, that this frame problem is not like this problem, which is rigid externally, which is rigid when supported, and when it is removed, it is non-rigid. You can convince yourself, okay, do some geometrical thinking, and that geometrical thinking, I am sure most of us are used to, but what I am saying is that this we emphasize to the students, that you do some geometrical thinking, that if I remove this from the supports, what happens? Can I change the configuration of this without deforming or without changing the length of any member? In this one, the students can be convinced, okay, if we tell them that, okay, just think about it, what way the members can move, this is a rigid member, even when you are releasing it from the support, and then we are putting, and then we know that if you have a rigid body, from all our exercises we did yesterday, that if you have a rigid body, we put a support such that all the reactions are not parallel to each other, neither do they intersect at one point, then the rigid body is appropriately supported. In this case, two reactions, horizontal, vertical, only horizontal, they are not intersecting at a point, they are not all parallel to each other, so we are done. This internally it's a rigid member, okay, it's not a mechanism, and externally it is properly supported, so it's a proper structure which is statically determinate. Let us quickly do a count on what are the equations, what are the unknowns. One unknown, two, three unknowns. Internally is a hinge, 4, 5, okay, 2 force member, 6. So we have 6 unknowns. How many free body diagrams can we draw max? 1, 2. So 2 free bodies, 6 equations. So 6 equations, so per free body we have 3 equations, so 3 into 2, 6. Number of unknowns is 6, number of equations 6, statically determinate structure, okay. So we are good. Now we want to find out in this case, okay, that for this member, what are the components of force exerted at C on member BCD? So what are the reactions at C which are exerted at BCD? So essentially the problem demands that we need to draw the free body diagram for B, C and D. Now let us ask ourselves a question. If we draw the free body diagram only for BCD, just BCD, then how many unknowns do we have? We have one reaction which is the unknown, we have two unknowns here, three. And we have this force unknown, 4. So we have 4 unknowns and 1 free body diagram. So what does that mean? And that what we emphasize to the student, that even though we are asked to find out the reactions acting at point C on this member, just drawing 1 free body diagram will not be enough. Why? Because this free body diagram has 4 unknowns and we have only 3 equations, so we need extra free body diagrams. And now how about extra free body diagram? Just ask ourselves, if we know this horizontal reaction at B, then clearly for this free body diagram, the only unknowns left are this 1, 2 and this 3. So 3 equations, 3 unknowns, we are done. Now the most naive thing to do would be, for example, I take this free body diagram, expose all the unknowns 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, oh, sorry, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, take this free body diagram, 1, 2, 3, 4. But then what will happen is that if you write down the equations of equilibrium separately for this and for this, you will get a bunch of simultaneous equations. There is nothing wrong with that. In principle, it is perfectly fine, but in practice, this procedure is prone to errors. So we choose our free body diagram judiciously. We say, okay, let us find out the reaction at member B. Now we ask ourselves a simple question, what if this roller were not there? Okay, what if this roller were not there? We can immediately convince ourselves is that this force will tend to create a moment which is in the anti-clockwise clockwise direction about point O, and as a result, this entire member will tend to tilt like this, and this will try to press inside. Now what we see is that, what is this member be doing? It is preventing the motion of this thing in the horizontal direction. So we expect that because it is trying to move inwards without the presence of the roller, the reaction will act outwards. In principle, there is nothing wrong with taking the reaction acting in the other direction also, but our intuition tells us that this will, without the presence of roller, this will try to move inside, and as a result, the reaction, our intuition tells us, will act in the outward direction. So what we do is that typically is we try to do here is we try to emphasize to the students that use your intuition Okay? Don't rely fully on it, but use it as much as possible to get some idea about what will be the directions, whatever directions you have opted, do they make sense or not make sense. So our intuition now tells us that the direction is in this way. Now what we do? We assume our direction in this way. Take torque about point A. When we take torque of this entire free body diagram about point A, you can easily do this and we can find out what is the, we don't need to find out Ay and Ax, okay? We don't need this for this problem, but say we got it. Taking moment about point A, we immediately obtain what is the reaction B. Our assumed direction is this, the value we obtain is 300, which is positive. So our intuition about the reaction being in the inward direction was right, okay? So that is how we confirm our intuition. Now what do we want? We draw the free body diagram for this member. Now this particular slide from Beer and Johnston is extremely good. Why? Because as far as teaching students is concerned, it is telling, for example, that what are the possible errors that the students do. One of the most common errors that we have seen students do is failing to recognize that this is a two-force member. So they would just say that, oh, it's a member, it's a pin connection. So these are some of the mistakes which typically students make, and you would also be aware. This is just that I am reminding ourselves that what kind of mistakes are possible. So one very common mistake is that students don't realize that it's a two-force member, it's a pin joint, degree of freedom restricted in horizontal vertical direction, replace it by 2. Okay? So they do that, that is clearly an error. Second thing, for example, that this, they may forget, for example, the vertical reaction. So that is another error. Another thing what they can do is that, again, FDX, FDY. So even add this, this error and this error put together, you can do this error. So typically, as we all know, that a free body diagram for this, that 300 Newton reaction, which we had obtained just a few moments ago, because joint C is a pin joint, it is preventing relative separation between this member and this member in both the horizontal and the vertical direction. We have to replace that. When we draw a free body diagram, the kinematic constraints are replaced with corresponding reactions, Cx, Cy. And now for this member, what do we have? We have 1, 2, 3 unknowns. The direction of this force is known, straightforward. Now what do we do for this free body diagram? Take moment balance about point C. We can immediately find out what is FDE. When we find out what is FDE, we are done. Now we can take force balance in the horizontal direction. We can find out what is Cx. We can take force balance about the vertical direction. We can find out what is Cy. And for extra confirmation, what we can do is find out this Cx and Cy for this free body diagram. We take moment balance about point D and that will come out to be 0. So that is our confirmation. So very simple problem, straightforward problem. The only reason we took it is that many a times, even simple problems, students make those errors because they don't recognize that there is a two-force member that is lurking there. Okay? So we can get this and we are done. So what another check is that we, and a better check again, okay, actually this is a really good check, is that so far the two free body diagrams that we have used is the complete free body diagram and this diagram. Now a check, better check will be that we have never used this free body diagram. But we have used all the information. So using two free body diagrams, we are not going to get any additional information. So what we can do is that we can now take just this member and use all the values that we have obtained and just see that if this moment balance, force balance stays or not. And if our entire procedure is clear, then this balance will happen. And this is a consistency check for us just to be sure that there are no errors in whatever we have done. Okay? This is not going to give us any new information. This is only going to give us a check. That if this is equal to 0, everything balances, then our approach, our procedure is perfectly right. Now, the last topic, okay, this is just the last topic. There are plenty of problems that we are going to solve, but the last topic that we are going to deal with is machines. Now, what are machines? Typically, a simple example of this machine, okay, is this is a plier, for example. What is this? What does this plier do? That we apply some force P, and that force P is effectively transmitted to this structure, a small structure. This can be a wire, this can be a bearing, anything. It can be a ball bearing, anything. So this force from here is transmitted to this point. Now what is the purpose of a machine? The purpose of a machine is that for example, if I want to cut something or want to crush something here, for example, this can even be a betel nut cracker. So if I want to crush something here, I need to apply huge amount of force. And that particular amount of force, okay, for example, most of us humans, okay, unless somebody is a superhuman, okay, unless you are a Krish, for example, you cannot do this thing. But now what you do is that you use something even better. We use a machine, and when we use this machine, what happens is that we keep the lever of this much larger compared to the lever of this. We can draw now the free body diagram of this particular component. We see that this is the pin connection which is preventing the separation between the top and the bottom portion. So that will lead to two reactions. Now if we take for this free body diagram torque about point O, what you will see is that at P times A is equal to Q times B, or Q or the force that is generated at this point will be equal to A by B times B. Now if we keep this A reasonably large, what you will see is that A by B is equal to P, and if this A by B ratio is large, then that means that a small force can be greatly magnified, okay, as this one, as the corresponding jaw force. So with this much of the preamble, we will now solve some problems, okay.